You're listening to the audio production of Calm Your Anxiety, 60 Biblical Quotes for Better Mental Health by Robert J. Morgan, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author.
Introduction. I've been robbed many times, and it's no fun. Sometimes the creep enters through the front door. Sometimes he breaks a back window. Once he cut a hole in the roof. On every occasion, he's after only one thing, my peace of mind, the calmness I need to function in life. His name is Anxiety, and he's a killer. He wants me to worry myself to death. He's plying his wicked trade against millions and billions of people, for the world is more anxious than it's ever been. Pandemics and politics have made things worse. Wars and rumors of wars have put the whole world on edge. Personal problems and family issues can worry us to the point of wanting to die. Our whole world is being plundered by fear in its many forms. Thanks be to God, I've increasingly learned to thwart this hideous villain. Doctors and counselors have helped. Friends and family have been invaluable. But by far, my best defense is the book that I hold in my hand and the God who gave it to me. The Bible is packed with chapters, verses, truths, promises, commands, and antidotes to worry and anxiety. Each sentence is a sharp weapon against the enemy, a two-edged sword, as we read about in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. In my fight against worry, I've chosen a biblical hero, Eleazar ben Dodo, as a model. He was one of David's mighty warriors who fought the enemy with such relentless force that after the battle, his hand was frozen to his sword and his men had to help pry it from his grasp. You can read the story in 2 Samuel 23, verses 9 and 10. Well, we have God's word as a sword, and as long as we wield it in the power of God's Spirit and in the name of God's Son, Jesus, will be safe and secure from all alarm. The devil attacks us with anxiety, but he cannot penetrate the defenses provided by the God who never worries, who controls time and eternity, and who works all things for our good. So don't give up. Not ever. You can usher archenemy anxiety to the door, throw him out, lock the bolt behind him. As the scripture says in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 4, be careful, keep calm, and don't be afraid. Do not lose heart. I believe the Bible is the best self-help book ever written because it's our God Helps Us book. Among its many passages on inner peace, three are classic anti-anxiety passages that I've memorized. Psalm 37, verses 1 through 8, where David said, do not fret. Matthew chapter 6, verses 25 through 34, where Jesus said, do not worry. And Philippians 4, verses 4 through 9, where Paul said, do not be anxious about anything. And Calm Your Anxiety, 60 Biblical Quotes for Better Mental Health. I focus on that latter passage, knowing that millions of people claim Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 as their favorite verse of all. It says, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. We're told that if we follow the strategy of Philippians chapter 4, especially verses 4 through 9, the peace of God will rule our hearts and minds, and the God of peace will be with us. That is His promise, and it is our reality. I want to suggest you spend 2 months, 60 days, looking carefully into these verses with me. Each day's reading is short, biblical, and practical. In the process, our gracious God will enable you to calm your anxiety with divine words inspired by Him who also calmed the raging sea. As you listen to each day's portion, ask God to make it real to you. Look up the verse references in your own Bible. If you don't have a Bible, this is a great time to acquire one. Use this book like a manual for installing a personal security system around your heart. Jesus said, The thief comes only to steal and kill and to destroy. I have come that you might have life and have it to the full, that you might have it, some translations say, in abundance. That's John 10:10. And when it comes to anxiety, it's time to throw the rascal out and let our Lord's abundant life fill our hearts and minds. God's peace is higher than earth's problems. His calm is deeper than our chaos. His mercy is wider, like the wideness of the sea. He can help you cope with these anxious times and live in the calm assurance of His overwatching eye. As Exodus 14:14 says, "The Lord Himself will fight for you. Just stay calm." Thank you for listening to this daily reader. Please consider sharing it with a friend or using it in your group study. And let me end with one of the Bible's great blessings from 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 16. "Now may the Lord of peace Himself give you peace at all times and in every way. The Lord be with all of you." Day 1. Psalm 9 verse 2 says, "I will be filled with joy because of you. I will sing praises to your name, O Most High." Several years ago, a religious teacher in India named Mahir Baba gained a global audience with his odd brand of Eastern mysticism. His most famous saying was short and simple: "Don't worry, be happy." In America, Baba's message struck a chord with aging baby boomers and coming-of-age Gen Xers, and one of his devotees, Bobby McFerrin, turned Baba's slogan into a popular 1980s song by the same title, "Don't Worry, Be Happy." McFerrin sung it in a breezy style with a playful Caribbean accent and dubbed in the instrumental parts with sounds made with his own voice. If only it were that easy. Imagine, what if a four-word slogan could transport us to a Caribbean beach with no shirt, no shoes, and no problems? If only a mantra could produce a life of cool drinks, lapping waters, tropical breezes, and orange sunsets. But life isn't an illusion, and worry cannot be managed so easily. It takes more than four words of a song. It takes the fourth chapter of Philippians and the solid truth it contains. The slogan, "Don't worry, be happy," may express the reality we want, but it provides no roadmap for getting there. It has no compass. It has no doctrine, no theology. It has no foundation in reality. It has pep, all right, but no promise. The Bible says little about being happy because happiness is an emotion that comes and goes depending upon our happenings. The Bible speaks of something deeper: joy and rejoicing, which are dispositions of the heart. That's why joy and sorrow are not mutually exclusive. Jesus was anointed with the oil of joy, and yet on occasion he wept. The Apostle Paul spoke of being sorrowful, yet always rejoicing in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 10. Happiness is an emotion. Joy is an attitude. Attitudes are deeper. They are richer. And the right attitudes provide the soil for healthier emotions as we mature. Emotions come and go, but attitudes come and grow. According to Philippians 4:4, the first step towards overcoming anxiety is cultivating the attitude of rejoicing. It's not, "Don't worry, be happy." It's, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice." It's possible for you to be joyful today. Here's a suggestion. What adjustments can you make in your own life to cultivate the attitude of rejoicing? Day 2. Isaiah 41:16 says, "You will winnow them. The wind will pick them up and a gale will blow them away. But you will rejoice in the Lord and glory in the Holy One of Israel." Rejoicing in the Lord demonstrates our willingness to trust God so much that our attitudes are affected. When we make up our minds to rely on Him in storm and sunshine, our burdens are lifted, even if our circumstances for the moment are unchanged or even deteriorating. When we stand on His promises, our spirits are elevated and our emotions lift upward as our perspective shifts Godward. Perhaps your spirits are low right now. Mine often are. But it is unhelpful or even unholy to remain in such a condition. John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, was blessed with a spry and resilient spirit. When a collection of his letters was published, his friend, Samuel Bradburn, wrote an introduction to the volume and used the occasion to describe Wesley's uncanny ability to remain buoyant in spirit. Bradburn wrote, "I never saw him low-spirited in my life, nor could he endure to be with a melancholy person. When speaking of any who imagined religion would make people morose or gloomy, I have heard him say in the pulpit that sour godliness is the devil's religion." In his answers to a letter I had written to him in the time of strong temptation, he had these words. He said to me, "Your melancholy turn is directly opposite to a Christian spirit. Every believer ought to enjoy life." Wesley never suffered himself to be carried away by extreme grief. I've heard him say, "I dare no more fret than to curse and swear." Well, Wesley's natural enthusiasm was buttressed by a firm belief that worry was as wrong as cursing and swearing. He understood Philippians chapter 4, verse 4. Rejoicing isn't just a good idea, a pleasant suggestion, or a laudable quality. God's people are to enjoy life. God wants you to enjoy life, even today. It's a command from the God of all joy who doesn't want His children doubting His providence, distrusting His promises, or discounting His sovereignty. He tells us, "Rejoice in the Lord always, and I will say it again, rejoice." Here's a suggestion. Think about a recent event or experience that caused you to be less than joyful. Think about your actions and how they created worry or anxiety for you. How would God have wanted you to handle that situation? Day 3. Psalm 13, verse 5 says, "But I trust in your unfailing love. I will rejoice because you have rescued me." Rejoicing in the Lord is not only a command we obey, it's a choice we make. God doesn't give us commandments without providing the grace needed to fulfill them, and I've learned the hard way that I must exercise control over my own attitudes. More accurately, I must let the Holy Spirit have control over them. I don't have to live at the mercy of my feelings. I can choose to smile, to get up off the ground, to cast a heavenward glance, and I can decide I'm going to serve the Lord with gladness. Now, frankly, it's hard to do. I couldn't do it without the truth of Scripture and without the grace of God. But there comes a time when we say, "I am tired of living in fear when God has told me to walk by faith and to rejoice in Him always. I'm going to change my outlook to an uplook, even if I have to force myself to adopt a better attitude." We all battle discouragement. We struggle with anxiety. But with the power of Scripture and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, we can learn to regulate our emotions. Perhaps we can't avoid being downcast, but we don't have to remain in that condition. We can say with the writer of Psalm 42, "Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God." We cannot afford the luxury of staying depressed or angry or anxious or fearful. We must acclimatize our minds to a higher plane by learning to rejoice in the Lord. Here's a suggestion. Ask yourself, "Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me?" And ask yourself also, "What one concrete way can I change my outlook and regulate my emotions better today?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.